versus 8 to 9. Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9 out of the NIV, it says, "But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, let him be eternally condemned. As we have already said, so now I say again, if anybody is preaching to you a gospel other than what you accepted, let him be eternally condemned." To me, that says a lot about the International Churches of Christ. It is a completely different gospel than what you're taught. I'll tell you a little bit about how I got pulled in. In May of 1988, 2 years after I'd been through 4 years of college, living on my own, and a friend of mine, I was going to Farmers Front Church of Christ, and a friend of mine started going there. He started studying the Bible, became a Christian, and about 6 months after that, he and another family just disappeared. Didn't know where they were at. And I got a phone call one day from my friend Doug, and he said, "Hey, there's this great church out in Irving. It's fun, you know, singing, and there's clapping. You know, you can clap during the worship service, which, you know, you kind of, sometimes you can't do that in some church services. But it just sounded like a really great church service." But I was already going to a church. I was already a member at Farmers Branch, and I didn't have a car. And so my idea of getting a ride with somebody to a church all the way in Irving seemed a little odd. And I was just kind of not interested. And I told him, I said, "Look, I'm already a member of a church." "Well, you should just come out and visit." He just kind of pressed it. And after a while, he convinced me to come to a small Bible study, just a little informal Bible study. And I'll tell you a little bit about that in a second. But I want to quote someone his quote describes where I was at after I left college. All right, and I'm quoting Matt Chandler, who's the lead pastor of the Village Church. He says, "I could talk sovereignty, retrib, post-trib, but I didn't have any love for anybody anymore. I could explain to you from creation to the fall, to redemption, to the return of Christ. I could sit around and give all the right answers. But when I went to bed at night, I knew the reality is that I hadn't prayed in a very long time." So what do you call a guy who knows all the answers but lost Jesus? Well, Jesus is going to say, "Listen, all your study, that's not the word abiding in you. Because if the word abided in you, you'd know me. You've studied in vain." That was where I was at. Yeah, I knew all this stuff, but I didn't understand a lot of it. Mainly grace. I just, for some reason, I couldn't wrap my head around the whole "you can get a free lunch" thing, is what I call it. Yeah. So, I'm invited to this Bible study. It's called a Bible talk. You might want to put that term down, Bible talk, in case you're ever invited to one. You know what it is. What these Bible talks are, they usually consist of 4 to 5 church members, and they call themselves disciples. They will not refer to themselves as Christians. Now, their scriptural reference for that is the word Christian is only mentioned in the Bible 3 times. The word disciple is over 280 times. So, they believe in using biblical terms, so disciples. These Bible talks consist of 4 to 5 disciples and one leader. He leads and shepherds the group. The main objective of the Bible talk leader is to instruct them in the word, encourage and equip them to reach out to non-members who are lost and unsaved. Now, the International Churches of Christ are also known as the discipling movement, the Boston movement. Sometimes it's even referred to as the Crossroads movement, referring back to their beginnings way back in the early 70s. The Bible Talk members may invite their unsaved to a Bible Talk meeting or a special church service or an event outside of church service, like a volleyball game or a Super Bowl party. These avenues are designed to introduce the disciples to new, unwary prospects. The number one goal of the Bible talk is to get these new prospects into Bible studies, which consists of a series of seven studies called the First Principles, which are specifically designed to show a prospect that as a non-member of the ICOC, he or she is not saved, needs salvation, and that through the ICOC, he or she can gain both that salvation and the constant discipleship necessary to retain that salvation. And that's one of the things that pulled me in, was that type of Bible study. All right. Besides Bible talks, disciples are encouraged to evangelize daily. One way is through blitzing, where disciples will go into a Walmart, shopping mall, or just walking in a park, and they'll just walk up to complete strangers. They'll just walk up to you and say, hey, you want to study the Bible? Which sounds a little odd, because you're like, whoa, you know, what does that mean? You know, a lot of times in the mall, they may or may not make a legitimate purchase, but their main purpose is to meet and make new friends and get them into a Bible study. All right. Another way to meet new people is canvassing neighborhoods. Obviously, you know, married couples will canvass their house neighborhoods. I don't know what to call those, but and singles are encouraged to canvass their apartment complexes. The last way of evangelizing is through double dates, annual normal daily conversation with people. A scripture that's used often regarding evangelism is Colossians 4 verse 5. And I'm going to read you two different versions. They use the NIV version Bible. They don't use different Bibles, or they don't have a special revelation or anything like that. They use the same Bible that you and I use, NIV. Nothing different than that. Colossians 4, 5 says, be wise in the way you act toward outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. So disciples are going to make the use of every opportunity. If they're at work, they'll evangelize at work. If they're in the mall, they'll evangelize in the mall. A lot of times, they will enroll in colleges, legitimately enroll in colleges, and take classes there, and create Bible talks on campus Bible talks. Now, these are public colleges. As far as I know, they are very wary of going to Bible college, Christian colleges. I think that would be a full onslaught. That I don't think that they're brave enough to do that. But again, their goal is to make Bible studies. Another favorite passage that they use is James 4:17. Anyone then who knows the good he ought to do and doesn't do it sins. So their compulsion is to evangelize. You know, Matthew 28:19 says, go and make disciples, baptizing them. That's one of their main key verses. You can't be baptized unless you're a disciple. And you can't be a disciple unless you're one of them. You can't be a disciple in Farm Fresh Church of Christ. You have to be a disciple of the International Church of Christ. Do you see the hook? Okay. After a prospect has studied first principles and has agreed that he or she is not saved or a Christian or a disciple, and they've agreed to be baptized again. Yeah, your baptism before you became a disciple really is invalid, because you were a disciple before you got baptized. You just, because you weren't a disciple, okay? Once you've agreed to be a disciple and got baptized, then you're a true disciple and a member of the kingdom, the one true church. Because discipleship is so important, the first principles is